And again, we're so excited. Easter Sunday next week, that's when we finish off our series. Now today, we're going to continue on in our Easter series. Today is part 3 of this series. The series is called Jesus Paid It All, and He Did It For You. We're talking about ultimately the huge sacrifice that Jesus paid so that we can have a relationship with God, a relationship that none of us deserve, but yet God loved us so much that He was willing to pay the ultimate sacrifice so that to fix His wayward children and help them come home. And so that's what we've been celebrating. We've been talking about that, talking about how much God loves us, and today we're going to talk a little bit more about that. And again, we're going to celebrate on Easter Sunday the ultimate victory and the significance of what that means to us, not just now, but for eternity. But before we get started with today's message, would you please pray with me? Father, we just want to thank You again so much for today. We thank You, Father, that we get to come together and just remember, Father, how loved we are by You. Father, too often we're so distracted by the things of the world, distracted by the stress and the work and all the things that need to happen, that we forget that You have a plan and You have a purpose for our life. Father, that You love us unconditionally. Help us through today's message and next week as well, Father, to remember, to step back and to remember that that love is really shown by sacrifice, and You showed us through the cross. You didn't just tell us, but You showed us how much You love us. We pray, Father, that because of that, we'll all be bold. We'll be confident as we move forward into our life, that we're able to live out the purpose and the plan that You created for us, and to pray that today, that as we see the prayer that Jesus prayed right before His crucifixion, Father, that we understand how significant we are to You. And because of that, we strive to make You proud. Father, the reason we follow You is not because we're trying to earn Your love. But Father, help us to see today that the reason we follow You and we do what You say is because we have Your love. Thank You so much, Father. We pray so in Your Son, Jesus' name. Amen. Again, if you want to take out your notes out of your program, you see that the title for today's message, we're going to be doing part 2 of Jesus' prayer for us. And we're looking here in the series, again, that Jesus paid it all. And if you remember, we've been talking about this, and we want to make sure that we celebrate Easter big, because Easter is what it's all about. That, you know, too often what we do is we allow Easter to come and go. But really, I mean, if it wasn't for what happened on Easter, we wouldn't have an opportunity to have a relationship with God. So we want to make sure that we take the time to really, you know, put our heart and our mind in the right place so we focus where it needs to focus on, and that is ultimately on what God did and what God constantly does on our behalf. So we want to spend the whole month leading up to Easter celebrating that, thinking about that, and having the right focus. So if you remember last week, what we did is we started talking about Jesus and a prayer that He did prior to His betrayal and crucifixion. And I thought about that, because if I was about to be betrayed and killed, you know, I sat back and started thinking about, you know, what I would pray about. Because Jesus, during this time, if you would think, it would be very justified for Him to pray for Himself. If you know what you're about to go through, and Jesus did, Jesus knew what was about to happen to Him. It said that He knew, and at that point, He explained to His disciples, He explained to them, here's what's about to take place. So, and what was wild is this, is I thought to myself, how often do we, whenever something bad happens to us, or we know something bad is about to happen, the focus doesn't go onto other people, the focus goes on to ourselves. It's all about God, help me. God, give me. God, be there for me. God, give me comfort. God, this. It's all about us. But what's interesting is this. Jesus, during the toughest moment of His life, He was about to endure the toughest physical moment of His life, He did not pray for Himself at all. But instead, He prays for us. He prays for us saying, God, here are some things that I want them to know. God, here are some things that I'm asking You to do on their behalf, to help them in their life. I want you to know that that's what shows God's love for you. That Jesus Christ wasn't focused about His own comfort. He was focused on you. He was focused on me. He was focused on the fact that He wants us to have the life that God intended for us to have. If you remember, we started looking at that prayer here in John chapter 17, verses 1-3. I actually put it right there in your notes. In that box, it says this. Jesus spoke these things, and lifting up His eyes to heaven, He said, Father, the hour has come. Glorify Your Son, that the Son may glorify You. Even as You gave Him authority over all flesh, that to all whom You have given Him, He may give eternal life. So those who come to God through Jesus Christ may have eternal life. This is eternal life, that they may know You, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom You have sent. It says that is eternal life, that we get to know God. You notice He didn't say that you know of God, but that you actually get to know God. That God is not just this distant being, but He is a heavenly Father. And we're talking about that today. That Christ wants us to have that relationship, that tightness with God that He had. That God is our heavenly Father as well, and He wants us to have that close relationship with Him. Now, if you remember, this is when He started praying. He started praying for people, saying, God, I pray for their eternity. But then he goes into some specifics. He says, now, while they're a part of this world, God, do this for them. If you remember last week, we started by looking at the five things Jesus prays for before his crucifixion. And number one right there in your notes for last week was, God, give them protection. If you remember, we talked about the fact that we now live in a fallen world. That when we rejected God at the very beginning with Adam and Eve and all of us after this, we rejected God, we ruined God's perfect creation, and then now we have issues and problems a part of this world. But the reality is we don't have a God, a heavenly Father that just says, you ruined it, too bad, do it yourself. But we have a Father that wants to protect us and guide us and direct us and be there for us. So Jesus prays, God, be there with them. Protect them from the enemy. And we talked all about that last week. The next thing that Jesus prayed for was, God, give them unity. That one of the ways that God protects us is with each other. That too often what we do is there's too much bickering happening within Christians. It's crazy. It's crazy. It's not about a church. I want you to know it's not about this church over here and that church over there. It's about the church, us coming together and being the people that God intended for us to be. And within the church, there's too much fighting, too much arguing. Let me tell you something. You know, there are so many different personalities in a church, so many different likes and dislikes within a church. But like we talked about last week, that if we are all following the same leader, we can't help but be united. Remember, we talked about how you can take a room full of crazy five-year-olds that are going nuts, and you say, hey, follow the leader. You should just start walking. Guess what? They'll follow. So the reality is there's no better leader than Christ. So because of that, as we follow him, we can have the unity that God intended for us to have in his church. All right, so now that's what we talked about last week. Now this week, we're going to look at the last three things that Jesus prays for. And then at the very end of the service, we're going to celebrate communion. And I'll talk all about communion and the importance of it when we get to that. All right, so the next thing that Jesus prays for is this. God, give them joy. God, give them joy. Let's go ahead and look at John chapter 17. Again, we're going to spend all of our time today, or most of our time, in John chapter 17. John chapter 17, verse 13. Here's what Jesus prays. It says, but now I come to you, and these things I speak in the world so that they may have my joy made full in themselves. So Jesus Christ says, God, I want them to have my joy in them. I want them to have a joy that goes beyond circumstance. You know, and it was funny because I started looking at this. I started looking up pictures of Jesus this week, just on the internet, on Google, because, you know, Google gets it right every time, right? And so I jumped on Google, and I started looking at pictures of Jesus, and it's crazy. It's crazy how they portray, you know, Jesus is portrayed today. You know, first of all, every picture, he was extremely pale. And then I'm like, man, you know, he's in the Middle East. He'd be tan, okay? But seriously, he's really pale. But then the other thing was this. He's always sad. Every picture, he's like this. He's somber. He's looking down. And I'm wondering, I'm going, why? Like you don't see very many pictures of Jesus. Tell me, when was the last time you saw a picture of Jesus smiling and being full of joy? So what happens is this is most of the stuff that we see was in the last hours of Jesus' life. But we don't you know, remember that he lived a long life. What happened to his other 33 years before, you know, his betrayal and death, burial, and resurrection? What happened before all that? Here's what we see. There was joy everywhere. Oh my goodness. Everywhere Jesus went, there was a party. There was a crowd. Thousands of people hovered around him. You know what? They won't hover around somebody who's walking around like Eeyore. I mean, that's not going to happen. But yet, whenever they came to Jesus, you knew that there was something exciting. People couldn't wait to be around there. If he entered someone's house, that house was full of people. There was, at one point, people were so excited to see Jesus, to have one of their friends be around Christ, that if Jesus could just touch him, just talk to him, they literally made a hole in a roof and dropped him down in front of Jesus. That's how important people, whenever Christ impacted other people, whenever anyone interacted with him, they couldn't help but walk away with joy. So why do we walk around thinking that God doesn't want our joy today? Listen, God wants us to be joyful. He wants you to have an amazing life. He is our heavenly Father, the same way that any good father wants to see their kids smile, wants to hear their laugh. That's the same thing that our heavenly Father wants from us. You know, but too often what we do is we confuse something. And what we confuse is joy with happiness. We do. You know, because what we do is we want to, we can be happy when everything's going great, right? When we got that raise, that's a pretty happy moment. But then when your wife spins it, it's gone. You know, right there. I'm just kidding. You know, but you have happy moments. And so what happens is this, is we confuse happiness with joy. But see, happiness is momentary. Happiness can be taken just like that. You can have happiness in your hand, like I got this thing, and just one phone call with bad news, that happiness is gone. But joy that Jesus gives us is something deeper. It's long lasting. You could truly have joy in the middle of bad circumstances is the type of joy that Jesus gives us. And Jesus gives an amazing illustration. See, right now we're in John chapter 17. If we go one chapter before this, in John chapter 16, as Jesus was telling his disciples about, you know, his death, burial, and resurrection, he was telling them all about what was about to happen. And in John chapter 16, verse 20, he explains the type of joy that we're going to have, okay? It says this, "Truly, truly, I say to you that you will weep and lament, but the world will rejoice. You will grieve, but your grief will be turned into joy." See, he's talking about what was about to happen. See, you're going to be sad because I'm going to be put to death. But don't worry. 3 days later, you're going to be turned to joy. You're going to see what's about to happen. And then he goes through and he says, now let me paint a picture for you, okay, how this is. And he talks about women. He says, whenever a woman is in labor, she has pain because her hour has come. But when she gives birth to the child, she no longer remembers the anguish because of the joy that a child has been born into the world. And I thought about that. See, what he's talking about is this, is that when you have something that brings you deep joy, you can put up with the pain. Now, I don't have any personal experience of passing a baby through my body. And I'm so thankful that God didn't have to do that. Because let's admit, if mankind had to be the one to be pregnant and give birth, we would be extinct right now because we're wimps. You know, we claim we're all tough. We're not that tough. You know, but women are tough. I mean, you guys put up with all kinds of crazy stuff. But here's what I do know, and I've seen this. Well, you can have a woman who gets pregnant. She gets morning sickness, there's vomiting, there's all kinds of stuff. You can't, there smells make you sick, you know, you have all of that. You could tell when somebody walks in when they ate garlic, and you're like, are you kidding me? You know, and so you go through all that, and then the birth and all the pain. Now there are some women who your birth maybe just took a couple hours. There are some women who have told me days of being in labor. I am so sorry. That is horrible. I would have just said, just kill me right now. Just kill me. It's okay. I'm ready to go. You know, but so you go through all of that. You know what's wild is this, is that I have never heard of a woman that after the child was born and they went through labor, they went through morning sickness, that they hold the child in their arm and the doctor hands the baby to them and they look at him and go, why did you do this to me? You made me sick. You made me so, I went through so much pain for you. None of them do it. You know what they do? They say, my baby. And they just smile. They just went through some of the most horrific pain they will ever go through. And now they're overwhelmed with joy. And Jesus says, that's the type of joy that I bring to you. That no matter how bad the grief gets, know this, I will bring you joy. And the joy that I bring, see, grief and pain is temporary, but the joy that I will bring through that is so long-lasting that I will do something great. And Jesus Christ, through the cross, he showed this, that the cross was the time of grief, but the empty tomb was the time of joy. So he's showing right there, look, every grief that is thrown your way, I can turn into joy. If I can do that, I can do anything with the grief in your life. So let me tell you something. If you're here today and you have grief in your life, you're going through a tough time right now. You know, when we look at the amount of people that come to church, we know that somebody walked in. You know, maybe you walked in just going, I just don't know if I can go one more day. You're feeling grief. You're feeling broken relationship, maybe financial, maybe a health situation, whatever it is that you're going through right now. I want you to know something, that God can bring you joy in the morning. That all grief is temporary, and through the cross and the empty tomb, God showed us that nothing is impossible for him. That there's no grief too big that he can't bring you joy. Now there's an amazing verse in Psalm chapter 30, verse 5. The last part of Psalm 30, verse 5. Listen to what it says here. It says, weeping may last for the night, but a shout of joy comes in the morning. It says, you might be right now hurting, but don't worry. Hey, it's right around the corner. God's going to do something great in and through your life. Now, let's admit, when I think about that, I go, wait a minute. So you're saying that joy comes after grief. Can I have a side of joy with no grief? You know, because I got to tell you, I have to admit, if there was a box that you can check, the first box is, hey, have grief or have some joy after grief or have joy with no grief. I check that one every time. Yeah, I would love to have the joy without any grief. But the reality is this, again, we live in a fallen world. So in this world now, we're going to have grief. We're going to have pain. We're going to have issues, but God can bring us joy even through the pain and through those issues. And I thought about that because I truly believe that the way you can have true, deep, meaningful joy, sometimes it's because of the pain. You know, there are times when you can appreciate over here the joy because of the pain you've gone through. I've seen people who don't appreciate some amazing things in their life. You know why? Because they've never had the pain of earning it. I've seen kids, I mean, we've seen it, where they're spoiled. They never had to work for anything. They've gotten everything handed to them. Later on, they're so entitled. They have it. They're like, what? Why shouldn't I have it? It's almost as if they are owed that. But when you didn't have that, now you have what you have. You're like, are you kidding me? You are filled and overwhelmed with joy. You know, people ask me, they're like, you know, Pastor Juan, you always seem like you're in a happy mood. Yes, I love my life. I love my life. I really do. And part of the reason I love my life is I know what life I came from. I know what it is to be without a father for most of your life. I know what it is to grow up to be, try to be a man and figure that out on your own. My dad left when I was 8 years old. I had to figure it out. My mom at 13 kicked me out. She chose her boyfriend over me. I was walking the streets trying to figure things out. I know what it is to feel rejected. So now when I'm over here and I have my family, my church family, the wife God gave to me, are you kidding me? Of course I'm full of joy. Are you kidding me? Sometimes it's because of the pain that you feel that depth of joy. And I want you to know something, again, that God can bring joy in any situation, even the worst situation that could ever happen to us. Physically is death. And yet, through Jesus Christ, it's a one-way ticket to paradise. That's it. That's it. Even the worst thing the devil could ever do to us, there's joy in the morning. How awesome is that? So Jesus prays, God, that's what I want. I want them to have joy. That's number one. Let's turn over your notes and let's look at the second thing that Jesus prays for. Jesus prays, God, give them purity. God, give them purity. Let's look at verse 17 now. John chapter 17, verse 17, it says this. Jesus prays, sanctify them in the truth. Your word is truth. Now, the word sanctify in this context, the Greek word is hagiazo. Hagiazo, which literally means purify. He's saying, God, keep them pure. And now you think about it. How hard is it to be pure now in today's society? I mean, there's stuff that tries to steal our purity like that. I mean, just even schools have changed like crazy, but TV, it's nuts. I mean, you could be watching something totally innocent and then boom, a commercial comes on and you're like, are you kidding me? Like every Carl's Jr. commercial, remember, you know, they always had the girl with the burger. I'm like, what does that have to do with the hamburger? You know, I mean, it's crazy. You can't even watch the Super Bowl. You know, you're watching Super Bowl. You want to watch football. And what do? The commercials in between there. You're like, are you kidding me? I mean, it's crazy. What about the music? Oh, man. You listen to some of the music today? It's insane. But I it was funny because I started, you know, kind of being old school. I said, man, the music today is horrible. And then I stepped back and started thinking about the music that was around when I was growing up. And I was like, ooh, man, because my Snoop Dogg days were not good days. I'll tell you that. So I stepped back and went, ooh, it's been a long time. Then I thought about this. It has been a long time. Because when Jesus says, God, keep them pure, he said that 2,000 years ago. Purity has been around for a long time. Us straying away from it, us going in the wrong direction, us being, you know, impacted by people around. I mean, that's what, you know, the Bible talks so much about lust. I mean, lusting is a big issue. I mean, ladies, you know this. When a guy walks in with skinny jeans, no, that's not lust. That's just making fun of them. Never mind. Don't do that, guys. All right. I don't know how that all came about, but it needs to stop right now, you know. All right. So, but seriously, you know, and purity isn't just talking about sexual stuff. Purity is also talking about, I mean, anger. I mean, think about this. How hard is it? Because purity just means this. Do good. Think good. Have good in your heart, in your mind, and do good things. How hard is that to do when you're angry? Let me tell you something. When I get angry, purity is not what I'm thinking. I'm thinking I'm going to just smack them in the name of Jesus. That's what I want to do. I mean, that's what we want to do, you know? But so it's hard. It's hard to do the right thing when we're angry, to stay, keep those pure thoughts. What about if somebody hurts you? Man, that bitterness that can grow, It's like a weed that grows inside of us. I mean, it can overtake us that we become so bitter and enraged. I mean, when we want to do the wrong thing. So how do we do it? When people can make us angry, when things in the world are just thrown at us everywhere we look, how do you stay pure? I mean, just the internet alone. The internet alone. I mean, you could just be searching something innocent, and then boom, something inappropriate pops up. So how do you stay pure? It said it right there. You notice what Jesus said? It says, sanctify them, keep them pure, God, in the truth. Your word is truth. It's right here. God's word, his Bible. Too often what we do is we try to find answers all over the world. I have people tell me like, hey, I'm trying to fix this situation in my life. And I've looked all over Google. I've checked Instagram and Facebook. I'm like, you're looking in the wrong place. It's right here. You want to know how to do life right? God tells us how to do life right. The creator of life is the one that shows us how to do life right. And so the reality is this. It says, spend time with God in God's word. That'll help our focus be in the right place. It'll help our focus stay away from the bad thoughts, the negative thoughts. So what I want us to do is let's do a homework assignment. You know, this week is the week right before Easter. Easter Sunday is next Sunday, 1 week from today. 7 days. What I'm asking is that we read a chapter a day leading up to Easter Sunday in John chapter 14 through 20. It's the entire Easter story. This week, let's focus on the entire Easter story. You're going to focus on all that happened to Jesus prior to, and you can see how loved you are by God because he didn't have to endure that, but he did it for you. You can see what happened, you know, during when he was buried in the tomb and the devastation that was there, but then you're also going to see at the very end the victory, the empty tomb, and ultimately how we are victorious through Christ. So spend time this week just looking at that. If you read one chapter a day, 5 minutes, that's all it'll take you. 5 minutes a day, read that chapter. Now, I've had people tell me, Pastor, I don't have 5 minutes. My life is crazy. And I go, are you kidding me? Because I checked on Facebook, and you had about 100 posts in one day. You know, so if your life is that crazy, then why is there so much time on Facebook, you know? And they're like, oh, well, it's because I do that in the morning to relax. See, what I do is I wake up at 5 a.m. I got to be at work at 8. I spend an hour on Facebook, and I'm going, So it's not that you don't have the time. It's the priorities are all wrong. Ooh, somebody right now went, darn, Pastor, what you doing? Oh, yeah, you know, but that's the truth. It's the truth. It's about prioritizing the right thing, you know? And so we got to spend that time with God. Now, I've also had people say, well, look, in order to be pure in this world, you really have to just walk around with your eyes closed because there's so much stuff everywhere. And then I thought about that because I heard a story about these monks that ended up moving there on this mountainside, and that's where they stayed. But every time they had to go and get supplies, they had to go into town. So, but they didn't want to be defiled by the world. So what they did is whenever they came into town, they kept their eyes closed. They were the black and blue monks because they were bruised up from hitting walls all the time, I guess. I don't know. No, but they would walk. Somebody would literally walk them through the town to go get stuff. And then they would go back, and they're like, because we do not want to be defiled. But the problem is this, is that's not what Jesus said it is. Jesus did not say here that the way to not be defiled was by closing your eyes to the world. Jesus said, by the way we stay pure is by opening our eyes to God and his word. That's how we stay pure. It's by spending time with God. That's what focuses our heart where it needs to be. I mean, listen to what it says here in Titus about where all that stuff, all the corruption comes from, okay? Too often people try to blame the world and go, it's because the world is so bad that I have all those jacked up issues. No, it's because you let the world do that to you. That's really what it is, because look what it says right here. In Titus chapter 1, verse 15, it says, to the pure, all things are pure. But to those who are defiled and unbelieving, nothing is pure. But both their mind and their conscience are defiled. It's from the inside out, not from the outside in. It's what we allow to affect us, to impact us. It's what we allow to put into our lives. You know, one of the things I tell my kids on a regular basis, whenever they ask me, like, hey, Dad, can I watch this movie or this show? And if it's a show that's wrong, that's inappropriate or scary or something, I tell them, I'm like, look, you have to remember something. You can never unsee that. You know that? Once you see something, you can never unsee it. It's there for the rest of your life. There are times when I will have a nightmare today about something that happened when I was 8, 9 years old. It's insane. Once you've experienced it, you can't forget about it. And something will trigger that thought out. So I say, be very careful to not expose yourself to things. See, we're like sponges. You take a sponge, whatever you pour into that sponge, it holds it. Now, sometimes we'll hold it at the back part of our brain so we don't think about it very often, but you know, it'll creep up. Something will happen that'll bring that thought up. So this says, be careful about that. You know, but the other thing is this. People say, well, what about when people do us wrong? It's hard to keep our mind right when people do us wrong, because I just want to, you know, retaliate. I want to, you know, lash out or you know, be angry right back. And what I tell them is this. I said, look, first and foremost, I've had people come up to me and say some pretty crazy stuff after service. I mean, literally, I had one guy come up to me and cuss me out after service. You know what was wild is he never even went to church. He was going from church to church. He came right between services and says, you're the pastor? I'm like, yes. And started, I haven't heard that many F-bombs in a while. I was like, wow, okay. You know, we had to learn some other words, you know, breaker words in there. But, you know, but so he just started going off about, you know, churches are this. And I asked him if he came to church. He said, no. He was going from church to church, telling him, you know, how he felt. And I'm like, okay. And so I tried to talk to him. He didn't want to hear it. But I got to tell you, when he left, you know, I wasn't full of anger. I was a little confused going, wow, that was a sideswipe. You know, but I stepped back and I thought about it. What caused that? See, he didn't wake up that morning, and yesterday everything was going great. He wake up that morning and go, you know what? Today I think I'm going to go cuss pastors out. That's not what happened. Something led in his life for this to happen. And when we start actually seeing people for the, you know, what they've experienced, and we try to, you know, at least not even walk a mile, just walk a few steps in their shoes, you start to realize that maybe that the reason they're lashing out at this is because they're hurting. And I think about this, that God loves them. God loves that guy. God wants to have a relationship with him. So as we look at people that have hurt us, this doesn't mean you have to be best friends with everybody. But what it means is this, we at least pray for God's best in their life. Maybe the reason they lashed out is because something's wrong. There's something else going on in their life. You know, the other thing that people do is they say, well, what about circumstances? There are some times when my circumstance is so bad and I'm just so angry. And what I tell them is this, remember this. There is no circumstance, no situation that Satan will do to you that God can't fix. That's why there's joy in the morning. See, the pain might be right now. Satan might be trying to get you distracted. But God says, but I will bring you joy in the morning. You stay strong, you stay focused. Keep yourself pure, thinking right. Keep your mind right, keep your heart right, keep your actions right. And God will make a difference in and through our life. Now that's the second thing. Let's look at the third thing. The third and final thing that Jesus prays for is in John chapter 17, verse 18, which is the very next verse. All right, so we looked at 17. So the first thing Jesus says in 17:17 is God, you know, purify them in the truth. Your word is truth. And then verse 18, he says this, as you sent me into the world, I also have sent them into the world. It says that as Jesus came into this world to make a difference with his life, that now Jesus sends us into this world to make a difference with our life. He says, I want them to have a mission. I want their life to be about something bigger than themselves, bigger than just going to work every day, you know, and coming home and having just food on the table, waking up the next day and just living life in a numb state. God doesn't want that for our life. He wants our life with passion, with purpose, with mission. And so he says, God, help them to see that the same way you sent me right here, I want to send them to have a life of purpose. But how do we do that? And what is that mission? He says it in verses 23 or 22 and 23. Listen to what he says here. It says, the glory which you have given me, I have given to them, and they may be one just as we are one. Talking about the church. I in them and you in me, and they may be perfected in unity so that the world may know that you sent me and love them even as you have loved me. It says that there it is. That's the mission. That the mission is to tell people about Christ who God sent and God's love for them. That the same way that God loves us is the same way that God loves Jesus as a father. See, we can't forget that. It's saying, God, I want them to know, not just for themselves, but for the world, that there's something bigger here, that I want to make a difference, you know, in their life. God, that help them to know that you are a heavenly father. See, too often people believe that God is up in heaven ignoring them. I actually just talked to somebody a couple days ago that said that they feel they're just kind of, you know, ignored by God. I said, absolutely not. Absolutely not. God never turns his back on you. And that's why I started talking about his life, and I found out it was him who turned his back on God. See, God never turns his back on us. Sometimes people say, well, God's mad. You know, God's not going to bless me because of all the bad that I've done. Oh, look at all the wrong I've done. There's no way that God, well, you know, wants to have a relationship with me. And I tell them the story of the prodigal son. Listen, the story of the prodigal son is a very clear, you know, story that tells you that there's nothing you have done that God can't fix. There's nothing you have done that will cause God to turn his back on you. The story of the prodigal son is a son who leaves his father, takes his inheritance, and goes and squanders. He just has loose living. He parties it up. He literally spent everything. He lived a horrible life. He then ends up literally in a pig pen, looking at what the pigs were eating. His life was devastated. He was looking at the pig's food, saying, "That looks good." He wanted to eat that. And then it says that he came to his senses. And at that point, he says, "Look, I have sinned against God. I've sinned against my father. You know, I need to go back to my father, and I need to be just as one of his hired men. I know he won't accept me as his son, but even if he just lets me be a part, let me be nearby, I'll accept that." And he runs back, and it says that as he's running back, that the father sees him at a distance, and the father then runs to him. You know why the father saw him at a distance? Because the father was still looking for him. The father never turned his back. He was wanting with anticipation for his boy to come home. Listen, maybe today you just need to hear, God just wants you to come home. Maybe you've been running for too long, and he's ready for you. What I love is what God did right after that. God, you know, it says that the father runs to his son, hugs him, he embraces him, he kisses him on the cheek, and he tells him, "Look, my son is home." And at that point, you know what he does? He does a big old party. The celebration begins. He said, "My son was gone, but now he's home." Listen, that's why we celebrate Easter, because it was because of Christ that we all have an opportunity to come home. And so maybe today, what you got to do is just accept that amazing gift that God wants for you. I mean, God loves you unconditionally. If you ever want to know how much God loves you, you don't have to look any further than the cross. When you look at what God endured on your behalf, it's absolutely incredible. Let me read for you something out of Matthew chapter 27. In Matthew chapter 27, verse 27 through 31, listen what happened the day that Jesus was crucified, okay? It says that then the soldiers of the governors took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole Roman cohort around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. And after twisting together a crown of thorns, they put it on his head and a reed in his right hand. And they knelt down before him and mocked him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat on him, and they took the reed and began to beat him on the head. And after they had mocked him, they took the scarlet robe off of him and put his own garments back on him and led him away to crucify him. You know, whenever I read that, I always get emotional. He did that for me. He did that for you. Jesus didn't have to go through that. For the wages of sin is death. That's what the Bible says. Jesus never sinned. Jesus could have ended it just like that. He could have stopped just like that. He could have at any point said, "You know what, God? They're not worth it. I'm done." But you know what he did? He said, "They're worth it." And he took it. And he cared so much about us. God loves you. God loves me. And God loves the world that's out there. All your neighbors, all your friends, all your coworkers, all your classmates, God loves them. And Jesus said, "They're God. The same way you sent me to show them your love, I want them, us, to go out into a world and show that world how much we love them." Jesus physically went through hell in this world so that we get to go to heaven for all of eternity. He did it for us, and he did it for them. So he says, "Let's get out there and let's make that difference." Now, we're going to tie this whole thing together with communion. Now, first, if you're here today and you have not committed your life to Jesus, we ask you to please not take communion today. We're going to have a couple people get up to get ready for the communion, to hand things out. But to not take communion today if you have not committed your life to Jesus. The Bible says that communion is an opportunity for us to remember the commitment that we've made. Remember the sacrifice of Jesus. So the big thing is that you have to have made the commitment to have a relationship with God. Now, I've had people tell me this. They said, "You know, Pastor, how do I know if I made a commitment to God? Because I don't really know." You know if you did. There's no question I gave my life to my wife. I married her. There's no question when I gave my life to God. You know when you made the commitment, when you said, "God, I'm ready to be all in my relationship with you." Not that we're perfect, you know, but the reality is when we say, "God, I'm ready to give my life to you." If you are here today and you have not made the commitment, you know, what we ask is this, is that today it's all about next steps. Today's not about taking communion. Today is about maybe you taking that next step. Maybe you're here today and you're saying, "You know what? I want to accept that amazing gift of God. I want to accept the fact that Jesus Christ paid the price for my sin. I want to accept the fact that he wants us to have unity together, that we're here to support each other. I want to accept the fact that God wants my joy, not my grief, that God wants to give me the life that he intended, a life of mission, a life of purpose. If that's you and you're saying, look, I'm ready to take that step, after the service, we'll be right up here. We'll be more than happy to talk to you about what that process is, what that next step is in your relationship with God. But hey, sit back, relax. You get an opportunity to see communion as well and see what it's all about. Now, if you will be taking communion, we're going to have the ladies go ahead and come on, walk on up. And they're going to start up here in the front, and they're going to work their way back. So they're going to start right here. So if you can just raise your hand, and then they will hand you a little cracker and a piece of juice. And then please don't eat it. I've had people just slam it before we're ready. You know, wait until I lead us through communion, okay? Okay, let's go ahead and do that now. Okay, does everyone have one that's going to be taking communion? Oh, there's somebody right over here. All right, now, before I lead us through communion right now, what I want us to do is just spend a moment right now to think about and focus on a few things that we should consider when we take communion. You know, the first thing we should consider is always stepping back and just acknowledging God's love for us. I mean, how loved we are by God. I think, you know, too often we get so distracted by the stress and the issues of, you know, of everything in the world. You know, even just social media alone. I mean, it's just crazy to see. I mean, it seems like the news, their job is really just to ruin our day, you know. And so too often what we do is we get so distracted by all that stuff that we just forget to step back and just remember that you are loved by your Creator. That God created you on purpose and for a purpose. That God has a bigger plan for your life. That if you're not dead, guess what? God's not done. You know, and so really, we just step back and remember that he loves us so much that he was willing to pay an awful death on the cross. When you think about how, you know, that sacrifice equals love. When we sacrifice for another individual, that shows how important they are to us. So I really do believe that the cross shows us how important we are to God. And he was willing to do that because of his love for us. The other thing we should consider during a time of communion is to consider our personal relationship with God. We're supposed to step back and evaluate, is there something in our life that shouldn't be there? Maybe there's something in your life right now that you go, you know what, I know God, this part, this thing is not honoring to God. You know, today commit to making that right. Commit to putting that, you know, whatever you need to put in place to make that thing right. God is putting that in your heart for a reason. If you don't know how to do it right yourself, it's okay. Hey, we're here for you. That's part of the unity that Christ talked about. That's what the church is here to do, is we're here to help you. We don't ever look down on anyone who's struggling. We're always here to give a hand up. We're here as a family. Which leads me to the next thing. The next thing that we should do when we do communion, as we come together, is to focus on the body of Christ, the church. You know, making sure that we are united. You know, the way that the enemy can take the church down is by dividing from within, by breaking us apart. You know, listen, we are all here very different people, different personalities, different likes, different dislikes. But how awesome is this that when we follow the one true God, when we follow his lead, we can all be united with a sense of purpose. And as Jesus right there prayed, that purpose is to never forget his love for us, but then also not just to receive it, but it's our job to give it out to the world. That we need to be out there, we need to impact the world around us. You know, as we talk about Easter and we're going to celebrate Easter, see, the reason we could celebrate is because we made a decision. And that decision is this, that when we accept Christ, we know where we're going to be for all of eternity. But right now, if the world was to end, you know people right now in your family, you know someone at your job, someone in your school, people around you, that if it was to end today, they're not going to be in a good, very good place. Those are the people that Jesus prayed for that you would impact. If you can think of a name right now, you think of a person, when I said that, that's God telling you, you need to impact that person today. Bring him to church next week. I promise you, Satan didn't put that name in your heart. God did. You know, so this week, what I want us to do is focus on, yes, God's love for us as we celebrate Easter, but then also allowing us to be a conduit of God's love. So this week, there are three ways I want you to try to focus on inviting people to come to church, okay? Three ways. You need to be ready for these. Number one, intentional. Intentional means already today commit, saying, I'm going to bring whoever it was that came to your mind, they're coming with me to church. I'll do whatever I have to do. I'll pick them up if I have to, get them in a headlock if I have to, in the name of Jesus, of course. Make sure you say that. You know, but whatever it is, you're going to bring them to church. Be intentional about it. The next one is, you know, maybe it's spontaneous. You're going to be going through this week, and all of a sudden a name's going to come to mind. You're going to see an old friend, invite them to come to church. And sometimes it'll be accidental, where you accidentally ran into somebody at the store. You know, that cashier that's right there, she's having a rough day. It's just a rough day. And you can say, hey, we're going to be celebrating Easter next week. And you hand them a flyer and say, I'm going to be at this service. You know, would you like to come to Easter with me? And then don't say April Fool's. You know, say it's on April 1st. But again, what this does is allows us to not just allow God to do something in us, but we're committing today through communion to allow God to do something through us as well, as Christ wanted us to do. You know that our life isn't our own. We're a conduit to make a difference. That's the purpose for our life. So let's go ahead and think about that for a moment, and then I'll lead us through communion. Okay, let's go ahead and take your cracker. The Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, this cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. And what I'm hoping, that was verse 25. This week, as we celebrate communion, I want to focus on verse 26, as it says this. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. This week, let's proclaim it from the mountaintops. Let's just do it. Let's be bold. It's not about being comfortable. When people say, look, I can't invite someone to church, it's uncomfortable. Let me tell you something. Jesus was very uncomfortable on the cross, but he did it for you. Let's not complain about how uncomfortable it is to bring someone to Jesus. This week, it's about focus. Watch God make a difference in and through our life. Let's pray. Father, I just want to thank you so much for today. We thank you, Father, that this week we get an opportunity to focus. Focus on what was important. Father, Jesus prayed about some things. Prayed about things for us. Even though he was about to endure such horrible anguish and pain, instead of praying for comfort, instead of praying for the pain to go away, he prayed for our best. Father, help us to never forget how loved we are by you. Father, help us this week as well to not just focus on accepting your love and it's all about what we get out of it, but help us, Father, to understand that when we accept your love, that we become a conduit to now express that love to other people. Help us, Father, this week to be bold, to be confident, to be uncomfortable, but to get out there and to make a difference for you. We love you so much. We thank you for all that you do for us, Father. I pray that this Easter that we honor you the way you're supposed to be honored. We praise your son, Jesus' name. Amen. Again, thank you so much for being here. I love you, church. Remember, next week we'll finish off this series. And don't forget to invite people to our big celebration after our third service. I love you. Have an amazing week. Thank you so much.